Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the afternoon sessions of the first International Conference of Thammasat Health Science. I'm Dr. Kesorn Sampaothong from Faculty of Public Health, Thammasat University. I am more than happy to be here with you as a moderator for this afternoon session. Before we go to the speaker, I would like to introduce the speaker a little bit more. You can see from the slide introduction. Professor Dr. Takeo about the knowledge, concept, experiences, and wisdom on the topic aging challenges and strategy for ASEAN country. This is a global issue and it's a very hot issue among the country where the population become aging society. As we could see from the history, actually Dr. Takeo Ogawa has worked extensively in Thailand. I would like to tell you a bit more about that. He's during the year 2018 to 2020, Dr. Ogawa worked with Bangkok Administrative Metropolitan Administration on the project of preventive long-term care to help the older person in Bangkok to prevent them to be a bedridden and to be strong enough to protect them from care. So this work has been extensively implemented in Bangkok. And also, Dr. Ogawa interested in the long-term care workforce, and he worked in many countries, for example, in Indonesia. So today, he will talk with us, active aging, challenges, and strategy for ASEAN country. Please welcome Dr. Takeo Ogawa.
Hi.
Hello, Dr. Ogawa. Are you ready to present your project? Yes. Okay. Please welcome once again.
Okay. I'll share the, my slide. Can you see? Can you see my slide? Okay.
Okay, very today, clear.
Okay, today I'll talk about three contents for promoting active aging. At first, please learn from Japan. And Japan is a number one age society in the world. And let's see this graph. The horizontal axis is the percentages of 0 to 4 age groups. The vertical axis is the percentage there were no aging country in Asia in 1970. This is a war only in Asia. In 2000, almost the Asian countries started to be low fatality and aging. Japan entered, which had 14% of 65 age group in the total population. In 2025, near future, some Asian countries shall reach in a phase of super age society. Also, many other Asian countries shall reach in age society. And the dependency ratio index shows how many people aged under 14 and 65 over are supported by the 100 people aged 15 to 64. In many countries, the dependency ratio has been down in the past. It was advantageous for economic developments. So we will express it as a society with demographic bonus. However, the trend more older people's surviving, but fewer younger people supporting them. Such a society is a demographic onus society in which the population becomes a burden for economic developments. In a global aging era, Asian countries are more rapidly aging than any other countries. We will be able to estimate three groups of aging phases in the coming 2050. Super aged society, Japan, Korea, Singapore, Thailand, China, and Vietnam. Aged society, Malaysia. Aging society, Indonesia, India, Myanmar, and the Philippines. Also, we will be able to estimate two groups of demographic bonus owners situation. Society with demographic bonus, Philippines, India, Indonesia, Japan had still many children and fewer elder peoples. After the World War II, there was a baby boom. Over the next 25 years, Japan achieved reconstructions and rapid economic growth by redistributing the wealth. All citizens were guaranteed pensions and health insurance system. From 1970 to 1995, Japan was an aging society. There was still a population bonus in these times. The retirement age has been gradually extended beyond 55 years old. This creation workplaces for the elderly has begun in various ways. Various initiatives for medical care and housing for the elderly has also began. After 1995, Japan entered an aged society and the stage of a demographic illness. A public long-term care insurance system has been established and the 60 years old retirement age system has been mandatory. Since 2005, as a super aged society, it's a time to verify and adjust whether the established systems are sustainable for the future. If your country wishes to learn from Japan, please notify your country's status quo and compare with past Japan. In order to promoting active aging in Asia, at first, let's look at the paradigm shift from the life expectancy to healthy life expectancy. Everyone thought it would be better to be longer life than shorter life, but it's need the much healthy lifelong in daily life. If you look at the life expectancy and the healthy life expectancy of a 60 years old person, you will find 4 to 6 years differences between them. This is a period during which long-term care are required. Then it will be a goal to make the differences as smaller as possible between life expectancy and healthy life expectancy. WHO presents a public health framework for healthy aging. I would like to recommend that WHO adds preventive long-term care initiatives to the long-term care axis if we can make use of our experience in Japan and Thailand. I think that is one of the challenges of active aging. I tried to disseminate preventive long-term care initiative in Bangkok through the JICA exchange program. Support skills of the preventive long-term care programs of locomotive syndrome preventions and dementia preventions. With 3 years of support, the Bangkok Metropolitan Administration has created a system to disseminate this program at all health centers and happy center. The prevent long-term care strategy recommends intervening earlier to improve people's lifestyles. Lifestyle habits that are not good for the health cause permanent diseases and cause situations that require long-term care later. Metabolic syndrome, locomotive syndrome, mild cognitive impairments, oral frailty, etc. are risky conditions that leave the elderly in a state of long-term care. To prevent this physical exercise, brain trainings, interactions with people, good diet, rest, sleep, and laughing habits are important. Why not extend healthy life expectancy by preventing frailty dominoes? Preventing long-term care will be an important strategy for achieving active aging. The second active aging strategy is a review of how Asian countries are too strongly dependent on their families. In order to realize active aging, it's important to build intergenerational collaboration across families and society as a whole. The concept of the family itself is extremely diverse. Emmanuel Todd, a French demographer, believes Asian families are roughly divided into three groups. First group is countries of authoritarian families like Korea and Japan. The second one is the exogamous families such as China, Vietnam, and Cambodia. The third one is an enemy family from the Philippines, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, Myanmar, and Singapore. But beyond those differences, the global economy changes families. Then, even if the country and the culture are different beyond the traditional view of the family, it's compelled to tackle similar problems. This graph shows families by the size of the household personnel and the percentage of people live alone. It's natural that there is a correlation between the reductions in household members and the increase in the rates of single person households. The problem is that such relationships are being accelerated by the impact of the global economy. When I visit Southeast Asian country that send out many migrant workers, I often hear about the family problems of step generation households. There is still an ethics of filial piety by sending remittance, even if it's far away, but it's a fairly unstable relationship. In the future, it will be necessary to create a state in which a society as a whole support each other in any family situation through intergenerational collaborations based on the ethics of the philanthropy beyond the filial piety. For example, let's look at the household types in Japan by age. Older persons, households are diversified. What cannot be ignored is that the proportions of the elderly living alone and living in institutions is increasing rapidly. Perhaps these changes may be a problem for the future in other Asian countries. Every society becomes a situation where the elderly cannot rely solely on their families. Japan is already such a society. Therefore, even if we live alone, we are building a care systems that supports all people's institutions and organizations around us. This is called a community-based integrated care system. In addition to the medical system, we have established the long-term care system built with institutions, daycares, and visiting services, as well as a system to support daily life in neighboring areas. Third, in order to advance active aging, we need to review our own life design. We need to rethink the life of a three-step model as before: learning when we are children, working in the middle of life, retiring and enjoying for the rest of life when we are elderly. This is because we have come to know that we cannot live actively for the second half of our long lives. In order to promote active aging in the future, it's necessary to shift to the life of the multi-stage model. The ideas of a life shift in an aging society was released a long time ago by social gerontologist Mathilde Narayri. Recently, Linda Grattan published a book as same as Narayri's framework. The multi-stage model is based on the learnings and the thinking about portfolios at every opportunity in life. In order to realize what we can do, we will find various employment opportunities that are not just about wage workers. We aim to live in a society where we can learn at any time, find other employment opportunities, and play an active role. One aspect of being active is that we are working. And working in society, that's why crafts and shops, there's no retirement age, so that the elderly can continue to work as long as they are healthy. If it becomes a society like Japan, where companies employ the workers for wages, the mandatory retirement will be imposed on the persons and they will be forced to evacuate from for younger generations. Then the elderly will not be able to work, and the pension system will have to be developed to the secure income for them. But in Japan, the employment workers rate of younger generation was high, and the high economic growth when there was a lot of the young workers. And now that we have a society with small young labor force, the employment workers rate is increasing even among the elderly. Let's see such a social change from the perspective of the active aging. In a society with many younger generation, it was normal to support elderly parent with the ethics of the filial piety based on the family ties. It can be said that the elder person was active in helping the family work and taking care of the grandchildren. However, if employment labor becomes mainstream through modernizations, it will be necessary to develop an imposed pension system that redistributes portions of the income of the employed workers to as the population ages. The burden of the imposed pension system becomes too heavy for the younger generation as the portion population enter the demographic onus era. Therefore, in a super aged society like Japan, we aim to work for anyone who is energetic regardless of age, and to work as much as possible with technical support, even if long-term care is required. And everyone is aiming for an inclusive society that is supported according to time and case. In other words, if aging is an unavoidable reality, it's necessary to envision a future society beyond employment labor. The concept of the future society has not yet been realized anywhere. Our long ways of life is the driving force behind building the futures we have yet to see. Let's investigate and learn what kind of way elderly people live actually and play role models in the society of active aging. Finally, based on these considerations of the active aging in Asian countries, I would like you to take this opportunity to conclude by asking to Asian Centers for Active Aging and Innovation to think about it. Center for Active Aging and Innovation was established in Bangkok. The center shall have five missions. Serve as knowledge centers of active aging and innovation. Support evidence for informed policies, strategies, and guidelines for active aging. Implement capacity development programs in support of active aging. Conduct research and developments and innovations which support active aging, and support the monitorings of the progress of active aging in ASEAN. ASEAN countries have an opportunity to study each other's experience critically and the future projections of active aging, and to create strategies for responding to new demographic transition. Therefore, I recommend three strategies for active ASEAN centers for active aging and innovation to promote active aging movements. First, let's take attention on healthy life expectancy more than longevity. Two, let's survey the change of families and the communities as an important background for active aging. Three, let's design new normal lifestyle beyond the current one. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Ogawa. Thanks for your informative and very, very interesting presentation. I'm sure that the listener, the audience will get benefit from that. Anyway, now it's time for the question and answer. I have got about three questions for you. Yes, and if the audience would like to have a question, you can write in the chat box and then our staff will collect it, okay? The first question, Dr. Ogawa, how can we help the country where economics still a problem? How can we help them to get involved or interested in active aging? Because sometimes they just look at how can help them when they get sick, but active aging is, we do not wait until the older person are sick. We help them before. And do you have any idea?
Yes, and still we have a misunderstandings of the situations of the older persons. In Japanese experience, maybe 65 years old and over population, in the population, almost the 80% are very healthy. Only 50% to 20% is some kind of a disorder. And how to motivate to active, to be active in healthy older persons? It needs some kind of a exchange of information of their status quo. Yeah, mm-hmm. And they must exchange their knowledge and the skills to maintain their healthy life. This is one point. The other one is that we must make a good gerontological studies for the healthy persons and also the frail persons. And we can get a fact-based policies and the movements we can study. And we can share the this kind of information in ASEAN countries and the East Asian countries, yeah.
Yeah, thank you so much. Another one question is about, you mentioned about Society 5.0. I think this is kind of the new strategy that we are going to use. Yeah, so can you explain a little bit more or give some an example to use it?
Okay, and in Japan now, our society is reached at a very high technical society. We call it Society 5. And it's a virtual reality and the physical reality should be combined with each other. And for example, mm-hmm. Medical doctor can surgery the patients through the robots. And the same thing. Yes. And we can employ some high quality of technologies for supporting all the persons. The older persons also using these kind of robots and ICT technologies and then make a good quality of independent life in a later life, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. I think we run out of the time now, although we still have some questions in the chat box, but I'll collect the question and pass it to you. Yeah, maybe you can answer through the email. Yeah, so at the end, ladies and gentlemen, we would like to thanks to the audience and also thank for the speakers, Dr. Takeo Ogawa, for his valuable time with us. And I really hope that this session will bring beneficial to everyone who want to use the concept of active aging in the future. So have a good day and goodbye for today. Thank you. ขอบคุณค่ะ